Hello, and welcome to week 9 in my reading journal. I'm going to switch things up a little bit for March and probably for the foreseeable future, where I'm not going to go through everything in the beginning, just one page, and then I'll go into the reviews and I'll leave all the rest of it for my monthly wrap up at the end. Okay, so going into here for at a glance. For week 9, I don't count Sundays. It looks like I read 4, but actually I read 5 books. The Velveteen Rabbit by Margery Williams, which I finished on the 26th of February. A Court That's Cruel and Lovely by Stacia Stark, which I finished on the 28th. Real Men Knit by Kwana Jackson and Matilda by Roald Dahl, which I finished on the 29th. And Into March, Love on the Brain by Ali Hazelwood, which I finished on the 2nd. Flip over and we'll get into it. Okay, The Velveteen Rabbit. I read this so that I could mark off rabbit on this bingo for February, and I had wanted to reread it anyway. It's only 34 minutes long, 40 pages long. It was originally published in 1921 through a newsletter or some sort of like a magazine type of publication, and then it was republished in 1922 in book form. I gave it 3 stars. Now, if you were to ask like 6 or 8 year old me, it would have been 5 stars. But as an adult, it was 3 stars for me. I got some of the imaging from Google, and the velvet, which also talks about velveteen, I got from an old Webster's dictionary. The song I chose for it was Unforgettable by Nat King Cole. It not only seemed to match the book, but it also matched my feelings about the book from my childhood. If you don't know the story, basically it's about a stuffed rabbit who was given to this boy for Christmas, but with all the other presents he got, the rabbit was kind of forgotten about and just sat on a shelf. And he got to know the boy's uncle's horse, who was very wise and told him about what being real was. And then the boy needed something to sleep with, so the nanny found the rabbit, and the boy became really attached to the rabbit, and that's how he became real. But real to the boy. Real as in like Toy Story real. And then the boy got really sick. I forgot exactly what he had, but it was something where back in the day, you could catch it again real easy from your stuff. So they would burn everything you had after you got better, so you wouldn't get sick again and nobody else would too. So the Velveteen Rabbit, along with a bunch of other stuff, got either thrown out or in a burn pile. But he ended up becoming an actual real rabbit. And later he saw the boy and the boy saw him, and the boy was like, oh, you look like my rabbit. So it was cool that they saw each other, kind of recognized, the boy kind of recognized him. He definitely recognized the boy. That was also why I chose this particular song for the book. And that's pretty much it. And then A Court This Lovely and This Cruel and Lovely, I can't talk, Stacia Stark. I gave this 4.5 stars. It was 14 hours long, 562 pages, and it was first published in March of 2023. It is book 1 of Kingdom of Lies. It is an enemies to lovers to maybe enemies again. I chose the song Castle by Hazley, which looks like it was part of a soundtrack, if you can see that, for I think one of those retellings of Snow White and the Huntsman. So in this world, when everybody is born with magic, but there was some sort of deal struck up with the gods, because they didn't want the Fae to be more powerful or something. Where as a baby, a priestess comes and she puts your magic into the stone to hold until your 25th winter, and then you get your magic back. But if for some reason your magic stays and you're found out, you're called the corrupted, and your whole family is then killed, and you're sent to a prison in the kingdom. And then on a certain day, like a holy day in a way, a holiday in a way, all those people who are corrupted get burned. And it's rather dark. So we're following Prisca, who is trying to hide her magic. She can't even tell her best friend. Her mom has trained her on trying not to show her magic. Her mom is a seer. Her dad, before he died, could mess with people's minds. Her brother was a healer, but he could only heal like small things, like scrapes, cuts, and bruises, and that kind of thing. And they move around a lot to try to hide her magic, because being a seer, her mom was usually welcomed into different villages. But she's found out. They come to get her, to arrest her, and in order to save her life, her mom pushes her into a river and she gets swept away, and then they kill her mom. That's how it all begins. So basically, it's about Prisca, and she ends up joining with these mercenaries, and she finds out that her best friend was also hiding magic, and she finds out that everything she thought is wrong, that she's not corrupted, that she's a halfling, and that the king is stealing magic for himself, and it's all this stuff. I could talk more about it, but I've already given a lot away, and I'd give way too much more away if I kept on going with it. I really enjoyed this book. I really did. And I can't wait for the second book. I was starting to get a little confused between this one and the other one I read, The Rise of the Dragons, but this one is much better. And yeah, it has like a whole intrigue, kind of a spy thing, and like rebels and mercenaries and magic and humans and fae and all of that. And it's a good read. I recommend it. And then also, in order to finish out the bingo, wherever that may be right now, I still had to fill in Friends to Lovers, and I'm sure something else. And also in my original bingo, in the front, I had to fill out like somebody knitting or crocheting in a book. So I picked Real Men Knit by Kwana Jackson. I had known about this book for a while, but didn't really know what it was about. I gave it 3 stars. It was fun. It was just fun. It was okay. It wasn't like any groundbreaking thing. It was something you might watch on Hallmark. It was 9 hours long, 336 pages. It was published in May of 2020, and it's a book 1 of 2. And what I love the most wasn't anything to do with the story, really, because I just love hearing knitting terms in like books and movies and all that stuff. So it was fun listening to the little knitting terms, some of the little knitting puns, and talking about like the skeins and all that knit and purl. And so I chose a song that I, from my personal like yarn playlist on Spotify, Cable Knit Sweater by the Lads, to represent it. Doesn't necessarily represent the story, but it does make me think of the story because of the song. This is what I was knitting while I was listening to it, which is a little Blythe dress, sweater dress. And I finally got to use one of my knitting stickers in here, which was fun too. Okay, so let's get back to the book. So the book revolves around a knitting shop. And right from the get-go, we find out that the owner of the knitting shop has died. And she had adopted four boys. The knitting shop's in Harlem. And she had fostered and then adopted and raised four boys. One, the youngest one, who is the main guy in the in it, they think he might be half white and half black. He's definitely black, but he might be half white. Then there's two who are actually half brothers for real, same mother, but one is half Korean and half black, and the other one they believe is 100% Korean. And then the oldest one is half black and half Latino, and he's very rigid and businesslike and very much a nice suit business guy. One of the middle brothers is a firefighter and the other one's a dancer. And then the youngest one, he just doesn't have his life together. They just think he's a mess. He's a loser. His name's Jesse. And then there's this girl named Carrie who had worked for, the owner of the shop, Mama Joy. And she always had a crush on Jesse, but Jesse's kind of a player. So Jesse wants to keep the shop going. It's good for the community. And the brothers agree to let him try to make it work. And Carrie's gonna help him get it going. And something happens in her apartment where she can't stay at her apartment, so she has to stay with him. They live above the shop. And one thing leads to another, and they're together, but she thinks it's temporary. But his feelings are deeper than that. And, you know, that whole thing where he's got to confess his love for her and show her that he's not just playing around with her. And basically, yeah, there you go. You can pretty much guess all the stuff that happens. But it's funny because it revolves all around this one knit shop. And talking about yarn and touching yarn and all that stuff. It's fun. Okay, and then Matilda. I quickly read Matilda. I stayed up super late to get it done before the end of the month was over, because both of these are read on the 29th. Because Matilda counted as a one-word title in my bingo, and I wanted to get as much of that bingo filled out as possible. I had not read Matilda before. I had seen the movie several times. It's by Roald Dahl. I gave it 4 stars. I was actually shocked I gave it 4 stars. I thought it was going to be a 3-star read, to be honest with you. I mean, the movie's great, but I have been disappointed by some of his books before. So it was definitely a fun read. It was only 4 hours long, 240 pages, and published in October of 1988. I chose My Girl by The Temptations for the song. If you don't know anything about this, it's about this girl who parents, her dad is a shady car salesman who does crappy things to sell cars to people. And the wife goes and plays like the slots or bingo. I think it's bingo. Like all day long, and they just leave this little girl in the house by herself. They only care about the son, her older brother. And she teaches herself how to read from all these different magazines or newspapers laying around the house. And then she finds out about the library. So by the time she's 4 years old and 3 months, she has read every single children's book in the entire library. That's when the librarian hands her, I think, A Tale of Two Cities or some other Charles, Great Expectations, hands her Great Expectations to read, and she loved it. And the librarian goes, you know, you can check these out and then bring them back, and you don't have to walk here by yourself all the time. So Matilda checks out books all the time and learns to read. And then eventually they put her in school. They put her in school later than she should have gone to school. She already can do math. Her teacher realizes how smart she is, tries to get the headmistress to move her up, and the headmistress is like, no, she needs to stay with her grade. And that woman is like an awful, awful woman. Miss Trunchbull is the headmistress, and Miss Honey is the teacher. So Miss Trunchbull is doing all sorts of horrible things to the kids, and Matilda soon learns that she has telekinesis, and she does some things back to Miss Trunchbull. She also finds out that Miss Honey is Miss Trunchbull's niece, and that Miss Honey's father died mysteriously, and that Miss Trunchbull kept Miss Honey as basically a slave. And Miss Honey lives somewhere where there's no running water, there's no electricity, no heating. She doesn't have anything but a crate to sit on in the house. And that's all she can afford because Miss Trunchbull takes most of her checks. She can only get like a pound a week or something, so she can barely live off of anything. But at least she's not under Mrs. Trunchbull's roof anymore. But that house belongs to her. Not Miss Trunchbull. The money belongs to her, not Miss Trunchbull, but Miss Trunchbull takes it all. So Matilda comes up with a plan to get everything back. And yeah. And it also talks about like why she might have the powers, the power of telekinesis, and why it may not stay around. So it was really cute. Okay, so into March now. And I filled out one of these for the bingo, for the publication dates, for the book I already read, one for one of the books I'm reading now. I'm not counting the other book yet because it's a physical book, although I think the physical book I might finish before the second audiobook, which means I need to change the numbers on some of these. But I've already started filling out the bingo. I won't really go into it because I'll cover all of this at the end of the month. And then I'm doing the Realmathon for the Realm of Shadows is my group. And that is hosted by Covers with Cassidy. I added a few point systems here and then Covers with Cassidy over here since my last video about going into March. And then I also added this page. I've only logged in one thing. I won't be showing this again, this page again, until the end of the month because I don't want to give away the points. I barely got any points for Love on the Brain. I only got 22 positive points for 4 of the 5 prompts I could choose from, plus the page points. The cover didn't give me any points. So Love on the Brain, it's the 33rd book I've read this year. And I gave it 3.5 stars. Ali Hazelwood, it's not her, her series isn't really a series. It's standalone. I did read it in order because I was told there would be some crossover in people, but there are no crossovers from the first book to this book at all. So it really is just a standalone book. Maybe there's some crossovers in the third book, which is why I started reading the first two in the first place, so I could get to the third book, which everybody's talking about. So it was 11 hours, 368 pages, published August 2022. I chose Love Cats by The Cure. Okay, so the two main people, Bea and Levi, they're actually into 90s music. That being said, though, Bea is super into cats. She loves cats so much. Levi has a cat. So Love Cats was just kind of perfect for it. So B talks about how Levi is her nemesis and that he never liked her and that he tried to get her boyfriend not to be with her. Her boyfriend was like a bad dude who cheated on her. That didn't work out. But as it turns out, what she's working on and hired to do for NASA is what he's leading. And she didn't know that. So now she has to work with her nemesis. But she slowly finds out. And I say slowly, the rest of us find out pretty quickly that he never thought of her as his nemesis. Not once. He never disliked her at all. And it was basically like her boyfriend who got him to stay away. He thinks she's married. She thinks he's married and has a kid. Both of them are single. He does not have a kid. There is a kid, but it's a different kind of situation. And while this whole dynamic is going on of him basically trying to show her, like, I don't hate you. No, I don't hate you. I don't hate you. No. Like, you basically have to drill this into her brain. Like, don't hate you. While all that's going on, she's having some serious work issues. And what I mean by work issues, I mean emails are not being sent to her or received by him from her. Text, anything to do with meetings and stuff that she's supposed to be at, she doesn't know about. She finds out after they've happened. She's blowing up about it. She thinks he's doing all this on purpose. And then you've got somebody else who the main boss guy wants her thing to fail because NASA doesn't want to share the copyright with anybody. But that gets fixed. But things are still going awry with the system, and they end up giving some guy a seizure, and because somebody's been messing with the computer system. And yeah, so the situation with that, I figured out who it was through process of elimination, right? And it's an unlikely suspect, right? But I figured out who it was. But I didn't figure out just how far it was going to go. And that's the surprising thing in this book, was not the love story, but this other side story and what happens with that. But basically, this is from her end, an enemies to lover. From his end, it's I guess, a second chance for second chance romance in a way, even though there wasn't, the first chance didn't ever happen and she didn't know about it. So it was a cute story. It was definitely a cute story. It was not a 4-star, but it wasn't like the bottom of a 3-star. So it was a 3.5-star. And I will be reading the next one, but I don't know if I'll be reading it this month or next month, just because of all the books that I have coming in from the library. It seems like they're all my holds are pouring in at once, and I have to delay some of the holds. And I don't know how many of my books will fit into the cover prompts for Realmathon. Yeah. Because most of my books do not have black covers. Right now, I don't think there's any buildings on any of my books. And I don't think any of them take place in a school setting. So I'm going to be purely going off the positive and negative. But, you know, every point counts. So we'll see how that goes. And I hope you enjoyed this more abridged, I guess, I don't know, shorter version of my weekly wrap up, and I hope to keep going with this kind of route where I just do the reviews and then do the wrap up at the end. All right, thank you. Bye.